I want us, as a congregation, first, to be in this word enough that we know right from wrong. There is a God. Evolution is a bankrupt joke. We were made by a creator, in the beginning, God. He gave us his laws. He gave us his ways. And those ways are for prosperity and success and order and love and peace and harmony.
Thank you.
you take your Bibles and open up to the first chapter of the book of Joshua. Moses is dead. That's the way it starts off. My servant Moses is dead. And you've got to kind of put yourself into Joshua's position. It wasn't just anybody that was dead. It was Moses. I mean, he held the rod out and the waters opened up. He went up in the mountain. The fire came down on the mountain. The water was poison. He blessed it and became clean and pure. They had nothing to eat. Cries to God. Manna comes down. Quail come in. This wasn't just somebody. This was Moses. And Moses is dead. And you almost, it's kind of like George Washington is dead. Who is going to ever fill those shoes? Type thing. And so it says, now after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord, it came to pass that the Lord spoke unto Joshua the son of Nun, Moses' minister, saying, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now therefore arise, go over this Jordan, thou and all this people, unto the land which I do give to them, even to the children of Israel. Every place that the sole of your foot shall tread upon, that have I given unto you, as I said unto Moses. From the wilderness and this Lebanon, even unto the great river, the river Euphrates, all the land of the Hittites, and unto the great sea, toward the going down of the sun, shall be your coast. There shall not any man be able to stand before thee all the days of thy life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with thee. I will not fail thee, nor forsake thee. Be strong and of good courage, for unto this people shalt thou divide for an inheritance the land which I swear unto their fathers to give them. Only be thou strong and very courageous, that thou mayest observe to do according to all the law which Moses my servant commanded thee. Turn not from it to the right hand or to the left, that thou mayest prosper whithersoever thou goest. This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein. For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success. Have not I commanded thee? Be strong and of good courage. Be not afraid, neither be thou dismayed, for the Lord thy God is with thee, whithersoever thou goest. Joshua was being put into a place of leadership, and his responsibility was to lead in such a way that the people of Israel would be able to inherit what God had promised them, and it fell on the shoulders of leadership to get them where they were supposed to go. Moses had committed a grave failure, and he was not permitted to go into the promised land, but Joshua was going to take the people there. And when I was teaching in the public school, I used to like to show, there was a series that the county library had called Profiles in Courage. It was actually a TV series, and they had gotten the films from it, from the book that President Kennedy had written called Profiles in Courage. And at the end of each of the series, it always concluded with the Liberty Bell ringing. All right, what? The Liberty Bell. A bell, like the Liberty Bell ringing. And President Kennedy came on and said, each man must look into his own heart for the courage to do what he has to do. And I remember distinctly one of the profiles in courage was Senator Ross from Kansas. And it was at a time before senators were elected. They were appointed by the states. As the Constitution was originally set up, the senators represented the states, and the representatives represented the people. And so the people didn't vote for the senators. They were just appointed by the state legislators. And Senator Ross was appointed by the state legislature of Kansas to represent them. And it was after the Civil War. And the President of the United States was Andrew Johnson, whom nobody ever, 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 ever thought would be President of the United States. He was only put on the ticket because Lincoln was running against George McClellan, who was the general that Lincoln had fired, but he was a copperhead, peace Democrat at the time. And Lincoln won, and Andrew Johnson was one of the two senators that never left the Union when their state did. And so they just put him on there to kind of draw Southern votes. So anyway, Lincoln's assassinated, Andrew Johnson's president of the United States, and the radical Republicans want revenge. And so and Lincoln wasn't going to do that. But the radical Republicans came after the president because the president, Johnson, was trying to implement Lincoln's plan. And they didn't like that. And so they made some unconstitutional laws, found him guilty, the president guilty of violating them, and then they impeached him. Now, the way impeachment works is you're not convicted. Impeachment is like a grand jury. They just say, seems to be enough guilt here to warrant a trial. And so the Senate had his trial, and it came down to one last vote. And that vote was Senator Ross from Kansas. If he voted guilty, president was gone. If he voted not guilty, president stayed. And all of the political establishment came against him. And they told him, they said, if you don't vote guilty, you will never hold public office again. And so in his spirit, he agonized over it, and he came back with a not guilty vote. And Andrew Johnson finished out his term. Senator Ross finished out his term, but that was the end of Senator Ross. He never, ever was able to hold public office again. You know, there are times in each of our lives where we have to vote our conviction. The political pressures, not only political pressures, but the social pressures that we are facing every day. What? Well, you're not going to do this, then you're not one of us. I can't imagine what the young people go through. What? You're not going to do this, you're not going to do that. And it takes an awful lot of courage to be able to stand at times for your convictions and your beliefs. And I would watch that bell swing and President Kennedy saying that. I remember this, I was saying to myself, okay, I know that there are certain things we need to do, and you're saying we need to be courageous, and God told Joshua he needed to be courageous, but where's it come from? How do you get courage? You know, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And there are certain things that you can do that will bring to pass in your life the things you're desiring. But where does courage come from? And I felt the Holy Spirit just drop a little formula into my heart. And it was like this: courage, truth will produce conviction. Conviction will produce courage. Courage will produce action. And actions will create results. Truth, conviction, courage, action, results. Well, what's the truth? Then the big question becomes the same one that Pilate asked Jesus. He said to Jesus, "What is truth?" And the answer to that, if you believe the Bible, is, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." And then Jesus said, "Father, thy word is truth." Now, the people that gave us our businesses throughout this nation, the people that gave us our constitutions, gave us our culture, the society that was derived from that culture, they did believe, and I can prove that to you, over and over again, they did believe that there was a God, that the Word of God was the Bible, and that it was the truth. That's why chiseled over where the Supreme Court justices sat in Washington, D.C., was the Ten Commandments. Okay? Because he, Moses, who's down there also with an open book, he is the great lawgiver. William Blackstone, who was considered to be the greatest legal mind of the period leading right before the development of the Revolution and our Constitution, said that law comes in two ways. There is natural law. Natural law would be the laws that we see in operation that are in operation because there was a creator who made it so. The second source of law is revealed law, which Blackstone said could only be found in the Bible. Okay? So we got Two sets of laws. Laws of nature, revealed law of God. So Jefferson comes along and he writes the Declaration of Independence. And he said, we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. And they're endowed by their
Creator.
And our president won't say that.
Creator.
He won't say that. I've saw him on more than one occasion where he'll quote that, but he will not say created or creator. And all men are created equal and are endowed by the Creator with certain unalienable rights. Among these rights are the right to life, the right to liberty, and really what they should have put there was the right to property, but because it came from John Locke, and Jefferson said the pursuit of happiness. Okay? But we hold the laws of nature and of nature's God. There they are. There are the two places that Blackstone said only law comes from. And then Blackstone goes on to say, if any law passed by man violates either the law of nature or the revealed law of God, it is of non-effect.
Amen.
Now, this might sound a little strange to you. I played for our senior learning center's history class this week, the biography done on public television on Robert E. Lee. And Robert E. Lee went through a tremendous, I assume you all know, Robert E. Lee was the leading general of the Confederacy during the Civil War. And Robert E. Lee was an extremely godly man. He loved the Lord. He insisted there be no swearing amongst his troops. He wanted Bible studies to be conducted, and he loved the Lord. And Robert E. Lee was torn between two loyalties. One was the loyalty for the Union. His father, Light Horse Harry Lee, had been one of the leading generals in the Revolutionary War, and Robert E. Lee had graduated from West Point and had been an officer in the Mexican War campaign and had distinguished himself there, came out of it with one of the leading reputations. And so when the Civil War broke out, the Secretary of War, underneath the auspices of President Lincoln, called him over. Robert E. Lee's home was Arlington. So he just had to go across the river and he said, the President wants you to be in command of the Union armies. And now he's torn. He's torn between two loyalties, because there was still this concept at the time of the Civil War that each individual state was a sovereign nation. It was sovereign. That what had been created with the Constitution was a system of federalism. And that the 10th Amendment to the Constitution of the United States declared openly that the federal government had only those 16 enumerated privileges. And then there was the elastic clause, that you got the right to pass any law you need to carry out these other 16. But anything that wasn't distinctly given to the federal government automatically went to the states or to the private individual. And so you have this system of federalism of sovereign states in and under a compact of government. So John Adams becomes president of the United States. It was at the time of the French Revolution. I'm sorry if this is boring you. I like. But it was at the time of the French Revolution. Now, some people in America felt that the French Revolution was just like ours. They were trying to throw off the monarchy and get rid of Louis and Marie, and they were just trying to create freedom. But some people got it. See, the American Revolution was based on Scripture. No king, but King Jesus. No taxation without representation, because you can't take the money that the Lord gave me and I am responsible to Him for without my permission, at least through a representative. You can't do that. and we weren't represented. And so no king but King Jesus. Jesus' sovereignty is above all other governments and kings and men. This was the heart of it. John Bunyan, who wrote Pilgrim's Progress. I don't know if you ever read Pilgrim's Progress or not. If you don't like to read, it's been made into a movie, and you can get it. Okay? But John Bunyan spent 13 years in a dungeon because God called him to preach, and the king said, "You can't preach unless I give you a license." And John Bunyan said, "No king can license what the King of Kings has called me to do." And that's all he had to do. I mean, they kept shoving this little thing underneath his dungeon door. All he had to do was sign that. His wife, his children grew up. He languished in that dungeon. But while he was there, he wrote Pilgrim's Progress. All over this thing of who's king, who's Lord, who will I obey? You say, well, that's nothing now. Now, if you go back to Vietnam, there was an instance there called My Lai. There was a young lieutenant by the name of Lieutenant Kelly, and he and his soldiers were patrolling through this village. And I'm telling you right now, in Vietnam, you didn't know who the enemy was. You could have a little kid come up to you and say, "G.I., you want shoeshine? G.I., shoeshine?" And a VC would have given him a grenade and pulled the pin on it, and he'd blow the kid up and blow the soldier up. You couldn't trust. And so these soldiers kept going through this village, and they kept getting shot. And finally, the word came down from above to Captain Medina, clean it out. Captain Medina said to Lieutenant Kelly, clean it out. Lieutenant Kelly and his guys went in, and they cleaned it out. They killed babies. They killed women. They killed everything. When this came up, he brought Lieutenant Kelly was the hung guy who was going to get hung for it. And they brought him in. They convicted him. He said, "But I was ordered to do it." They said, "Even if you were ordered to do it, you had a moral responsibility not to do it." Now, you've been in the military. You know, you do something like that. And anyway, they put him in Leavenworth Fort. We had the Nuremberg trials. Had all these Nazi henchmen. And they said, "We just did it because Adolf said to do it." And the judges at that trial said, "No, I'm sorry. There is a higher law than Hitler. There is a higher law than Captain Medina and the colonel and the general." Well, who is that higher law? We live in a schizophrenic country. On one side, you're saying, "No, you can't do that because that's immoral." And on the other side, we're saying there is no morality. There is no truth. There is no right. There is no law. Okay? And let me read you some things. Because I believe the United States of America is in a terrible situation. Yes. And it's got to be turned somehow, or the United States of America as we know it is going to cease to exist. And it's very close to being the case even now. William Ellery Channing was a preacher in the early 1800s. He was a Unitarian. And he wrote an essay called Religion and Society. And this is just a portion of it. And it says, "Religion is a social concern." So we have government that has gone to war against not all religion, just the Christian religion. It's not at war against Islam. In fact, government's out there seeing to it that Islam gets everything it needs, little tubs to wash their feet in, and we're not going to mess with Islam. You want to have Islam Day at the local public school? No problem. You want to have Christian Day at the local public school? I don't think so. So it says, "Religion is a social concern, for it operates powerfully on society, contributing in various ways to its stability and prosperity. Religion is not merely a private affair." So you say, do what you want to do down at the church. Just don't bring it outside the church walls. You know? Jesus said, "Go into all the world." Amen. and preach the gospel. He told Jeremiah, he said, Jeremiah, don't be afraid of their faces. Fear of man worketh a snare, it says in Proverbs. And so it says, the community is deeply interested in its diffusion, for it is the best support of the virtues and principles upon which the social order rests. How palsied would be human benevolence, you know, human goodness and kindness, were there not the sense of a higher benevolence to quicken and sustain it? How suddenly the whole social fabric would quake, and with what a fearful crash it would sink into hopeless ruin, were the ideas of a supreme being, of accountableness, and of a future life to be utterly erased from every mind. And our public schools are working diligently now to erase the sense of a higher benevolence and a sense of accountability. And the idea that there are absolutes is just anathema to much of our society and culture. What do you mean absolutes? There are no absolutes. Everything is relative. Everything is situational. And it says, were the ideas of a supreme being of accountableness and of a future life to be utterly erased from every mind, erase all thought and fear of God from a community, and selfishness and sensuality would absorb the whole man, appetite knowing no restraint and suffering having no solace or hope would trample in scorn on the restraints of human laws. Virtue, duty, principle would supplant every feeling, and man would become, in fact, what the theory in atheism declares him to be, a companion for brutes. And we see our society sinking into this morass of moral incompetency, murder, mayhem, rape, abortion, all of these so-called social issues. And you know, in one sense, I understand the idea that people should have a right to make a choice, because Jesus didn't make anybody get saved. Jesus didn't make anybody believe in him. Jesus did not make people give or do anything. He said, this is the way. Walk ye in it. But the problem is that we have a situation now where people no longer are being taught. When the Northwest Ordinance was passed, one of the reasons for its passing was in every township, they broke it all down into townships. Each township had, I forget now exactly how many sections, but each section was 620 acres. And in each township, there was a section set aside for a school. Now, it didn't take 620 acres for a school, so they could sell off the land to get the money to build the schoolhouse with. And the purpose, according to the Northwest Ordinance, was, first thing up, to teach religion. First thing, teach religion, teach morality, and teach science, in that order. Because unless our culture, unless we as people come to a recognition that we must be moral in order to be virtuous, and if we lose our virtue, we will lose our strength. That's why God said to Joshua, Joshua, you must meditate in my word day and night. And be careful to do what it says, because that will produce conviction. This is the truth. God is the truth. This is conviction. That will no, you can't do that. No. Well, everybody's doing it. No, I'm sorry. That is a violation of truth. So you'll have the courage to take a stand. And your courage then will produce a reaction. And then the action will produce results. And so we have to turn the nation around. We were a nation under God, a nation that had as its motto, in God we trust, no king but King Jesus, no government has the power to violate natural law or reveal law. So if you look at the constitutions of the states, the early constitutions of the states, besides the United States Constitution, you'll find it's right there in the preamble in most of them, you know, subject to God, in accordance with God, in accordance with his laws. Now you say, well, we didn't make people be Christians. They didn't have to be Christians. Nobody was hung on the gallows for not being a Christian under the Constitution. It's just that the morality and the unity, e pluribus unum, for many, one, there was a oneness, there was a foundation upon which to build oneness. That was Ten Commandments. Now, we're going to maintain our families. We're going to fight for our family. We're not going to lie. You know, I always wonder why in the world the United States ever tried to make a treaty with Russia. They're liars. I mean, you say, well, how do you know they were liars? Well, they were atheists. And an atheist becomes a very pragmatic person. And a pragmatic person is, my truth is whatever works for me at the time. So if I can lie to you and get what I want, that's why it's almost impossible to sit down and create a treaty with the Islamic world, because they have as part of their doctrine, it's okay to lie. You know, you just kind of hold to it for 7 years and then you can go do whatever you want to do. And so we need to understand what we're up against here. Now, that was William Ellery Channing. Bill Bennett got himself in trouble. He got hooked on gambling, but he seemed to be a pretty decent guy. He wrote a couple books where he went back and he got all of the old wittyisms and stories and things that children were taught. The Moral Compass and was one of the books. I forget what the Book of Virtues was the other one, and gave all the stuff that was pumped into me as a kid in school. And he gave this speech, and where he says this. He says, the enemies of moral truth declare that there is nothing worthy to which we should give allegiance, nothing deserving of our reverence, nothing elevating for which to live, and nothing, not family, country, faith, honor, or truth, for which to sacrifice or even die. Part of the explanation of why this has come to pass is that there is an allure to untethering ourselves from the claims and constraints imposed on us by moral truth. The wayward part of man wants to do away with rules, because where there are no rules, there are no wrongs. If it feels good, do it. Has its appeal. This temptation has always existed, but in the past, civilizations have found ways to fight back. Today, we seem less sure of our ground and whether we even want to fight back. To put it another way, although it is true that we all have an equal right to our opinions, it does not follow that every opinion is equally right. I mean, I guess we all have a right to think whatever we want to think, but if you think you want to come over and have me for supper, and not necessarily as a guest, but as the main fare, I don't like that idea. You know, not every opinion is equal, all right? And it says, there's no more important task in our time than defending truth against its enemies. So it is. And in a society without respect for moral law, a world of all against all, it is always the weak, the innocent, the vulnerable, who will suffer most at the hands of the strong, rapacious, and unprincipled. In a world where moral truth is denied or repressed, the reality is that, and here I come back to those Socratic dialogues, justice means nothing but the advantage of the stronger. Or you could put it the way Mao Zedong put it. He said, power grows out of the end of a gun barrel. Or you could go back to the law of the Old West. Whoever had the fastest gun was the law. You remember Liberty Valance? Yeah. Ever watch the movie Liberty Valance? And Jimmy Stewart's this lawyer that comes in from the East, and he's going to bring justice to the West. But there was a guy there by the name of Liberty Valance. And he was the law. You didn't do what Liberty said, he'd shoot you. All right? And so the struggle became one of, would the law win out over the raw power? And ultimately, John Wayne secretly shoots Liberty Valance, and Mr. Stewart thinks he has done it, and he becomes a hero, and law prevails in the West. All right? But this is a nation of law. Nothing should be able to alter that law without the people's will. Not somebody that just decides they don't want to enforce it. If the law is there for how to immigrate to this country, then that's the way you should immigrate to this country.
Amen.
And if we get away from this whole thing of this is law, then where are we? And in Proverbs it says, remove not the ancient landmarks. And I used to kind of mystify over that. Well, what does that mean? You know, other than just going out there, you don't want to, you know, out there in the ground, there's a bunch of concrete poles driven in that measure out each person's property. But what does that mean? Remove not the ancient landmarks. And I got to thinking about that. What would be the most ancient landmark in the United States of America? Would that not be the Constitution of the United States? That's our landmark. Okay? And you're not to remove the ancient landmarks without permission. So since we can't ever get the people, according to Judge Bork, to go along with certain things, the way we'll do that is we will get the courts of law to simply change the definition of words. Now, the words would be the landmarks of the Constitution, because those words carry with it the ideas and the ideals that created the nation of liberty. When I was teaching, I would ask my kids the question every year, what is the law of the land? Well, of course, the institution of that is Constitution of the United States. That's the law. And the fight when Judge Bork was nominated was, are we going to have a system of judiciary where original thinking, the definitions that was used to create the compact of government between the states, the sovereign states, and the federal government, are we going to go back to original understanding? What did those words mean when that was written? And then use that to judge by? Or are we going to rethink and alter the definition of the words? See, there's a way to change the Constitution. It's called amending. But not by judiciary. That's not the function of the judiciary. And so here we are in this nation, which is teetering on the brink of economic collapse, totally violent. It says in Deuteronomy 28, if you as a nation will obey my commandments, then you will loan to many, but you will not borrow. Because in the New Testament, it says the borrower is subject to the lender. And it's God's will that truth would be enthroned to create justice. You cannot have justice without truth. And so we're in the midst of this, and it's going to take courage on the part of you and me, our senator, our assemblyman, our governor. It's going to take courage. First, you're going to have to know the truth, and then you're going to have conviction. And then you're going to have to be willing to, Senator Vandrew has done that. He's taken the arrows and the barbs and the stuff that's come from people who didn't agree with him, and he stood. And it says, history has taught us too well, too regularly, too poignantly, that intellectual and moral disarmament leads to terror. At the end of this bloody, brutal century, with the searing images impressed in my mind and memory of Auschwitz, which I've been to, Nanking, the Soviet Gulag, the Cambodian killing fields, if there is one thing we have learned, it is that there are horrific human consequences to pernicious evil ideas. And no idea has more consistently done more evil than the idea that there is no right or no justice except as dictated by the strong.
Amen.
If the relativists are right, the relativists, all right, then as Malcolm Muggeridge once said, the cynics, the hedonists, the suicides would be right. The most we can hope for from this life is some passing amusement, some gratification of our senses in death. But as Muggeridge pointed out, that is not all there is. There's more to life than shadows and caves. There's also always sublime truth. Three final quotes, we're done. John Adams. John Adams said, we have no government armed with power capable of contending with human passions unbridled by morality and religion. Our Constitution was made only for a moral and religious people, It is wholly inadequate to the government of any other. Do you think he knows what he's talking about? I mean, he was there. He was one of the five that was sent to write the Declaration of Independence. But he said, I've got so many people mad at me that if I write it, they probably will vote against it just because I wrote it. So, Thomas, you write it. Adams also said, power always thinks it has a great soul and vast views beyond the comprehension of the weak. And that it is doing God's service when it is violating all his laws. And one last one. But a constitution of government, once changed from freedom, can never be restored. Liberty, once lost, is lost forever. I want us, as a congregation, first, to be in this word enough that we know right from wrong. Amen. There is a God. Evolution is a bankrupt joke. We were made by a creator. In the beginning, God. He gave us his laws. He gave us his ways. And those ways are for prosperity and success and order and love and peace and harmony. In Proverbs, it says that the Lord is the author of witty inventions. You ever ask yourself, why did almost all the inventions, the great inventions, come out of the United States of America? Why? Oh, it's because we Americans, we're something. What is an American?
That's right.
People used to say to me, well, Pastor Moore, what are you? I said, if I was in the dogdom world, I'd be called a mongrel. Or if it was my granddad Moore saying it, a shaggy-headed cur. Because there's nothing pure about me as far as genetics. America's not pure that way. America's always been a nation of nationalities. But they did have a unifying principle. It was called Americanism. And part of that Americanism were those Ten Commandments. This is what we drew our unity on. I don't care how you eat your rice. You can put sugar and cream on it, or you can mix beans with it. I don't care how you eat your rice. In fact, diversity is good in that sense. But we're not going to be diverse when it comes to right and wrong. We're not going to be diverse when it comes to injustice. We're not going to sacrifice justice for fairness.
Right.
And so I want each of us to become absolutely sure. As that bell rings, your Senator Ross, your whole future's in front of you, your Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. You are Daniel in the lion's den. You are Joseph in prison in Egypt. You are the person upon which the hope of this nation rests. It was people like you that hit the beach in Iwo Jima and Guadalcanal and at the Battle of the Bulge and Omaha Beach. It was people who knew right from wrong, and they were going in to clean out tyranny. I would say that's why Robert got himself hurt. He felt he was going to war to clean out a person who had gassed his own people with sarin gas, had killed hundreds. They uncovered hundreds, thousands of graves in Iraq where Saddam Hussein had murdered his own people. Some things are worth dying for. I don't care if you're a Baptist, a Methodist, a Catholic, a Lutheran, a holy roller. I don't care if you're a Catholic. We all have this book. This is the book. This is the book that tells us right from wrong, good from bad. We can come to the lowest common denominator, which is we hold these truths to be self-evident, that the laws of the Creator are the laws for which we'll live and die. Now listen, if there's somebody by home and TV, and you're listening, and you've been frightened and intimidated and scared about the things that are coming upon the earth, listen, accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Do it. You say, how do I do that? Say, well, first of all, believe that He's alive. And then say, Jesus, I receive by faith my forgiveness. And I receive You as my Lord and my Savior. And my confession is that my sins are forgiven. Do that. Do that. And then get into the Word and begin to renew your mind. And when the enemy comes with all these fear thoughts, you begin to confess the Lordship of Jesus. And you will know victory. And if you need prayer, call us. We've got people right down here at the church waiting for your call. Call us. And you can call us even during the daytime. The number's there. Somebody will pray for you. We love you. Jesus loves you even more. And there's good times for those who trust in Jesus.